Proceeding further, now we have Mr. Deepak Jaidka with us to share his knowledge with us.
I started in the email marketing trade. Yes. So how much do you know about email marketing? One is like, you know, I can send one-to-one email. But how about sending large amount of emails? Not just like a bulk SMS kind of a thing. We don't relate it to that. How about sending and reaching out to, you know, say masses like 40 or 50,000 odd prospects in the market? Any ideas on that? So how was the campaign? Marketing job?
It's good, like we need to upload the list first and then we need to send out the emails.
Alright. So, that's my Twitter handle. I give a big brief. Actually, she's already given a big brief. So I've been using Salesforce for almost like 9-10 years now. I'm a fan of Salesforce. So whichever company I jump into, I make sure that, you know, Salesforce is the software they use for the CRM. And you know, I am a bad guy for the Microsoft Dynamics because I'm anti-Dynamics kind of a thing. So I make sure that, you know, Salesforce is the product they use. Every sales guy can't survive without Salesforce. This is the kind of thinking I have. So one of the products by Salesforce is actually Pardot. And Pardot is actually you know, a kind of a marketing automation tool which can help you out, reach out to masses, but of course in a controlled way. It is not like sending emails like 50,000 or like, you know, sorry, not 50,000 but 5 million or like, you know, 20 million. Marketing Cloud is actually that solution. But if you want to reach out to a little small database, but then you want to nurture those leads over a period of time. So for example, I want to reach out to you. One way is like I can start selling something. I can say, hey, I'm from this company, you know, I have this lovely product or service. You want to buy this service or no? I mean, you know, I can be bumping, you know, I can send you some hot 20, 50 emails in, you know, 10 days, 20 days, and then you marketing kind of a spam, right? But that will not work. So what will work in this time is, it's all marketing automation wherein you target on the personalized things. So for example, you receive an email saying, hey Deepak, have you seen this or that? It means like, you know, this person who's sending me an email already knows about me, right? And rather it is saying hi, comma, and then you know about this thing. I'll still, you know, kind of have an idea and feel that, you know, I'm particularly a kind of a part of the bigger list or a rented list, you know, right? So people prefer their name, people prefer to be, you know, intimated based upon their preferences. So that's the kind of the market scenario as of that. A lot of the bigger companies like ours, which are working into the B2B space rather than a B2C space. So B2C is basically like Amazon and all these companies which are, you know, selling eBay or something like, you know, e-commerce companies. And B2B are those companies which are into selling their services or products to the other business companies. So I particularly, you know, happen to have my entire career in digital marketing only for the B2B space. I worked with Google India partners, I worked with a couple of other agencies, companies, and fortunately in this current organization also, it's all B2B. So, what else do we know about marketing automation from this group that we have today? So, for example, like marketing automation, I can kind of think, automating something? Is this that we feel or something else? Anyone? Want to answer? Any chart or? What is marketing automation? Okay. So and to you, what do you feel like? What is marketing automation to you? I mean, the word or the buzzword is there, and digital transformation, and then, you know, marketing automation, automating everything.
Yeah, automating the marketing part of the sales.
Hello. Yeah, actually like automating the part of the marketing strategy, whatever you've been doing, daily campaigning or like whatever, selling part of it, you add some automation to it or some AI to it, so that certain things that the marketing and the sales guy do, it becomes automated and given real-time results,
right.
So that they can move it and move forward in a quick way.
Right. Perfect, actually, right on the line. So last week I was in Mumbai for sales face camp even. And fortunately, I attended the keynote session by the SVPs of Salesforce, and they were talking mostly about the AI thing. So very well quoted somewhere on the internet, I found, going forward, real-time marketing is going to be the holy grail of marketing. So real-time marketing, we're talking about real-time. For example, I send an email to you, or based upon what is the kind of activity you have done. For example, I send you an email at 2:15. So did you actually open up the email at 2:15, 2:20, or in the middle of the night, early morning, whatever it is? So machine learning would come into the picture, right? That's actually the far-sighted goal. It is very much there by Salesforce. It is called as Salesforce Einstein technology, which helps you out with a lot of hidden information which you probably have to, you know, work out on it and actually see, okay, you know, this is working, this is not working, and you know, so on and so forth. So how do you send emails, like if you want to reach out to say 40,000-50,000 people, how do you send like emails? So a lot of companies would configure their Outlook, they'll send one-to-one emails, they'll have batch emails, mail merge kind of technologies, you know, those kind of things, maybe some free email applications like, you know, PDF banks and all that. Those kind of you know, non-performing, I would say, assets have been used by a lot of companies. Let me tell you one thing, that none of these have a very good kind of click-through ratio or a, you know, a good conversion rate coming out of it. So so any ideas about how you send like thousands of personalized emails in 5 minutes of our platform? Personalized emails, for example, all of the people sitting here, they all get an email with their first name, maybe somewhere in the journey, maybe in the content, talking about you only, your personal thing only. For example, someone likes Marketing Cloud, someone likes Sales Cloud, someone likes something else. So everyone gets an email based upon their, you know, previous history. So how do you send emails which are very, very personalized and, you know, within minutes? How do you send that? Any ideas? So marketing tools is, of course, there's a lot of tools that you need to use. Marketing automation comes into picture there. So there's a lot of tools like HubSpot, then Heatmap, then MailChimp, Constant Contact. So there's like array of tools that you need to integrate, and then probably, you know, map a journey, and then, you know, reap the harvest, get your reports down the line and think about it, okay, this is working, this is not working, right? How about having everything at a single platform, which is part of the part? For example, you have Hootsuite to send your social tweets, LinkedIn messages and everything. Then you want to track that. For example, I send it to Chirag or maybe someone else, this lady, right? So how do I actually track that, you know, this lady, I mean, what's her name? So Shifta has actually opened up any of my emails, or she has actually clicked to any of the tweets, right? If in case she has liked it, then only I'll get to know. Otherwise, if I want my tool to actually track that, you know, if she has actually not liked my post, if she has actually clicked on a link which was there in the post, and she has been to one of the landing pages in my website, that kind of a tracking is actually possible with the help of Power BI. So I can actually write a book on Power BI.
So there's a question.
Yeah.
Right.
That
somebody visited your profile.
So
how can it work? What's there?
Yeah. So what we can do is we can have automation tools, automation figures, tools set up in Power. It will tell me, for example, I want to track Shipra's activities. I can set up a kind of automation tool inside Power. I'll show you how. Then the Power will tell me real time. As soon as you come to my website, it will send me an email saying that Shipra has visited my website, which has been to these pages. In fact, for example, this morning you've kind of seen one of my posts. So the Power tool towards the day end summary, or, you know, based upon the kind of a setup that I've done, it will keep telling me that this is how, you know, Shipra has been interacting or, you know, engaging with my content. Because it's, so today it's more of like, you know, you don't have to sell something, you have to educate people. So once you start educating people really believe upon you, and then, you know, they come back to you saying, hey, no, I want to buy this service or a product. For example, so I'm not getting paid for this session, but for example, like, you know, I'm here to educate, right? I'm just telling you, it's more of like an awareness session where we are, you know, at the same platform discussing about Power. But once quite a time, you know, maybe six months down the line or maybe 1 year down the line, you start reading a lot about Power and you feel, okay, there's some kind of a department into your organization. I'm confident enough that, you know, Power will just reach you for you guys. And you'll actually reach out to any of the sales guys in Power. So this is how it happens. If I come to you and say, hey, you know, please buy this part or this and this, and I'll be telling you the details, you're not probably buying. If it teaches different way, it's worth engaging it, for educating you, sending some blogs and all that, that's how it will happen. And that's how, even in fact, in my organization, I've seen that thing happening. So how do you place this entire part of ecosystem? So for example, you have a kind of an email database of 40-50,000 emails or maybe a lakh emails. You put that up in a database, you import that up into the Salesforce part of system. From that part of, you have segmented list. So list takes care of the segmentation. And towards the next slide, I'll talk about, you know, the pro tips with why segmentation and why not the single list. So then, typically if you see a marketing campaign, if I have to reach out to masses, so probably, you know, I need to have a, you know, funnel created. So in a funnel, it is more of like, you know, awareness stage and some interest, some consideration stage, and then towards the end, it is more of like a conversion stage. So this is how the marketing funnel. So any of the marketing guys, any of the marketing people there, were into marketing? No. Okay. So I'm a digital marketer. Of course, marketing person, but then a little ahead of just the digital marketer. On a particular page you have read, what was the exit, what was the intent of coming, what was your source, what was the kind of content you have, you know, come from one page to another. So that's how we map your entire journey. So what happens is, you come to my website, you start the kind of engaging with my content, which I don't know as of now. Maybe like after a month you realize, okay, I want to buy this thing or a service. For example, like we are into B2B space, so we don't have products to sell. It's not a, you know, kind of a hardware that we can send or ship to you. For the expenses. So once you come to my website, you just write your name, email address, phone number, company name, and then say, hey, I'm interested in your services. How would I know that what kind of a particular service that you want to buy from me? Right? So what happens is, like, with all this digital marketing thing, with this, with the help of all the Pardot and, you know, the, all these Salesforce technologies, we get to know that you have been interacting with my website, my content, social media, and everything for almost like maybe like an year ago, which I never knew. But today, once I've left a lead on my website, now this entire thing, this entire 1 year back journey is actually collated in a one system. It's called as an activity sheet. And then you can actually see in the Salesforce. Because Pardot is integrated very well with the Salesforce thing. This is the activity system, which I'll show you. There you can actually track, you know, if a person has come to my website, how many times they've seen any videos or whatsoever it is. So, it looks really catchy when we say, how to send 50,000 personalized emails in 5 minutes. I was thinking, like, you know, people would be curious to know, okay, is it really possible to send like 50,000 emails in 5 minutes? There's a couple of things that we need to set as stage. More of like a prerequisite. So if you see, typically in a Pardot system, we have a list, we have landing pages, we have email templates, custom redirects, campaigns, and tracking codes. So now what is a list? For example, any kind of a database, like 50,000 emails, is a part of a bigger list. I can say global list. Then I can segment that list. This is what I have talked about, segmentation. So the pro tip is that you have a segmented list, for example, only for the US, only for the APAC market, only for the UK market. Right? And then after that, for example, I want to trigger a campaign which is only sent to the UK people. So then I know, okay, this will be sent at a BST. BST is British Standard Time. So we'll send it only at the BST, for example, 8 a.m. in the BST time zone. Mm-hmm. Which will actually fail if I send it from the Indian time zone. Right? Because, for example, I reach out to my office at, say, 9 o'clock in the morning. And the email pops up to my inbox at 6 in the morning because it was scheduled from India. It makes no sense because I'm not going to check their email, right? So what will happen is, we need to have segmented database, segmented list. And based on that, for example, if only for the US, you can have BST, PDP, and all those time zones, you can trigger that. And in fact, the same way, you can have AST and APAC and FD, Japan, and all those time zones. So segmenting the list from that point of view, for example, not only from the country or the geo, then segmenting the tactics. For example, I want to reach out to a CEO of a company. And I know a CIO will not have, say, 10 minutes to read my email. Huh? He'll probably have a minute. That's the thing you want to target, right? So in the corporate world, if you see, it's more like a 30 seconds elevator pitch. But you do it in 30 seconds. Whatever you can sell to me, it's only 30 seconds. If you can park an impression in my mind, I'll listen to you, otherwise, boom, gone. Right, so this is how it happens. So messaging will differ from a CIO, CEO, a manager, or a director, or people at the bottom of the pyramid. You know, people at the starter level. So people at the CIO level would just like to know, okay, the overview. Okay, what is it all about? That's it. People at the middle level would actually like to know more about it. Go for a deep dive. Okay, send me blogs, send me materials, send me this. People at the very lowest level would like to learn first and then jump on to something like this. So based on that, we need to create a lot of segmented data, segmented list, and like this, we can move forward. So once that list thing is done, we can have the Dreamin campaigns triggered that way. Then we can have landing pages. Landing pages is actually something like a particular product related or a service related page. For example, if you visit to my website, I probably have 20-50 links where you can go this way, read this, you know, watch this video, blah blah blah. But a landing page will make sure that you don't exit from that page. One main feature of a landing page is like it talks about only one thing. For example, if I'm sending an email which talks about, for example, Pardot, right? So it will not take you to Salesforce.com. It will actually take you to Pardot.com/landing pages. Now what that landing page will have, it will talk to you very briefly about the Pardot thing, and there's a form. Because the only intention is to get a lead out of it. Because any kind of an email campaign or any marketing campaign has an end motive, there's an objective. It's not only the branding. At the end of the day, you know, it's how many leads you generate, how many people in how many companies you can go to. And maybe the Lala or these company wala says ke bhaiya dhanda kitna hai. How will it come? It will only come by this way. So you need to have the lead generation campaign. So landing pages, they have a very, very, very big significance in all these.
Then we can have email
templates, which can be list email templates, which can be sent one to one or triggered. We can have some autoresponders, we can have some engagement or a drip campaign, and I'll talk about the drip campaign. That's the main power of Pardot. We can have some custom redirects, so like Shipra was asking, for example, she happened to like any tweets or she has seen my LinkedIn profile or she has been to any of the pages on my website. And I want to know that, you know, I want to actually track what is Shipra doing in terms of, you know, the engaging with our brand. Then I can have some custom redirects. So any of the emails which is, you know, so it's more of like a first interaction. For example, you know, the very first time in the life when, you know, my system interacted with Shipra. So she has, you know, happened to open one of the emails. So the moment she has opened up the email, there's a cookie which is dropped into the browser. Now that cookie knows that this person is Shipra, that cookie keeps on sending the information. So how many people there in the crowd who knew of this, the cookie things and, you know, the tracking which is available with the help of cookies? Great. So a lot of times I've seen people feel that, you know, I can delete cookies and I'm going to get tracked. So is this true or false? I can delete cookies, I'm not going to get tracked.
Partially true.
So, you know, there's something called as super cookies. So now, you know, the world is going ahead to that side. So it says that, you know, whatever information you have is actually getting stored into the ISP level cookie database. For example, Facebook. You can't really clear your cookies. Facebook has all the information, whatever is your interest, whatever is your liking, disliking, advertising. You like to travel a lot and everything. You can't really clear those cookies because Facebook has that entire cookie data saved into theirs. So that is how this entire thing is moving on. Next was the custom redirects and the campaign. Campaign is actually the base of the universe wherein we create a campaign, associate each of these assets to it, and then we move on. Next is the tracking code. That's the most important. This is how the cookies are getting tracked. So this is a small JavaScript code. There's no coding that we need to do. It's just a code which we can actually, you know, kind of get out of this Pardot campaign. Just paste that up, send it to a developer, or you can have a Google Tag Manager connected to your website. Just paste that up into the GTM Google Tag Manager, and that's how probably the system will start tracking every activity of the campaigns. So this is something like I've seen in my organization that I've worked. So I used to handle large teams, like 30-35 people deep, who were into the marketing teams and sending out emails. So I still have a team which is above 25 people, who are still sending manually emails. And then I have another team which is the part of user team. It's just like 2 people. still not able to come out of this, but yes, I'm sure that, you know, this is something which is bringing out a lot of results. Now, why? So why do people want to prefer Pardot-based smart teams versus actually Pardot teams and not the traditional teams? Because traditional teams, a lot of money can be invested, is actually invested on the resources. I have 25 people, all their salaries, all these systems, internet access, everything, blah, 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 I have to pay. Talk about the Pardot thing, I have one tool, it's just the cost which I paid. For example, a standard base package is like, say, 10,000 for a year, 10,000 USD for a year, right? It's like 5-6 lakhs or something, 6.5 lakhs, that's it. So I have invested only 6 lakhs, and just imagine the kind of investment that you need to do a, to create a team of like 25 people, which is almost, you do 1 CR. Right, so that's the difference between it. The work will be much more effective with the Pardot campaigns. So, you know, the companies are preferring to have small teams which are very smart, who uses a lot of automation, a lot of these tools which are available on the internet, and less of the bigger, you know, resources kind of teams. This is the kind of interface, like I told you about all these things, and I'll be covering slightly next. Next slide. So you can have automation rules, like Shivra was asking how we can get back. And all things can be done in the automation rules. Campaigns is to set the campaigns. For example, I want to send one campaign at US time zone, one campaign at our UK time zone. I can set like 20 campaigns, 50 campaigns. It's automatically. So for example, today I'm here. You know, my system is already sending a lot of emails. And I get the notification that, you know, this person has opened up, this person has clicked through some emails, this person is, you know, watching my video, interacting, this. So free kind of, so, but again, you know, I'm feeling like, you know, how can I actually as a single man handle all this data? So I'm just getting notified. Actually, it is more of about, you know, I have 720 sales guys. So all this data which is actually into the Salesforce or the Pardot system is actually connected to each of those sales guys. So for example, like in US I have 5 or 10 sales people. So any kind of lead from a US time zone, so all these people have a territory. So for example, this one guy say David or another guy say Joe. So, you know, they get notified in real time, but is their prospect going to their website? So, I am getting a shadow copy, but I am not going to send them and even say, hey, so, hey David, you know, do you know one of your prospect, you know, this kid has a website yesterday. Right, this is not my view. So, this is what is actually the part of the system is doing. You can have some, you know, targeted campaigns, targeted reports, those kind of things, and keep on happening. Next is the content for the landing page. This is something you need to do. You can actually create some content on landing page, make that look very sampling or jazzy, and then show that.
I have a question. You said the sales team gets a real-time
notification.
Yeah. How do they get? Do they need to have access to
Pardot?
Or do they have Salesforce?
Okay. So, you know, it depends upon actually, you know, how your company is actually using this Pardot. But Pardot works best with Salesforce. So I'm sure a lot of companies, or maybe your company would be using Salesforce for the sales guys. Pardot is connected to it. So it actually fetches all the data from Salesforce. Gets connected in real time, gets to know, for example, this particular case, say, the Shipra's case is owned by, say, Mr. A or David. Right. So David gets to know whenever Shipra does something with my friend. She.
For that, I understand, need to know Pardot. Do they need an engage license?
No, nothing. It's just the, so only the marketing team plays the game. And you know, these guys are there to, you know, have the low hanging fruits. They'll enjoy the issue. That's the answer.
So is it like Pardot is a sort of marketing automation tool that is in collaboration with Salesforce?
It is a product of Salesforce.
Product of Salesforce, not a separate entity.
No, it's a product of Salesforce. So Salesforce, typically for the marketing people, Salesforce has a marketing cloud, which man was saying. So that's like, you know, if you want to reach out to millions of people and less of a lead nursing, but the part of it is more of like lead nursing. I know that these 50,000 people are really very important for you. I don't want to, you know, just bang on their head and start sending something which makes no sense to them. I want to try some lead nursing campaign, send them something which is more relevant to them. So this is where Pardot comes in. So it cooks all your leads within the best of time. You know, 15 days trip campaign, 30 days, 45 days kind of a trip campaign. And that's how people will, you know, get nurtured on a series of emails sent by you or any kind of a, you know, the engagement with campaign that you set up with them, and they get hooked up, and towards the end you get a, you know, kind of a score, and then you in the next slide. And maybe, you know, even if I will feel in the middle of some trip campaign, you feel okay, I want to jump in for a one-to-one telephone for a in-person meeting with this person, you can set up. Next was the forms. Email, then the engagement studio. So engagement studio is the drill campaign. So for example, a lot of companies today also, 95% of the market, I would say, in fact, even more than that, is still doing it manually. So we have tools like, MailChimp or blah, 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 kind of tools which can help me reach out to 50,000 email prospects. But what is the problem there? For example, I can set a campaign, say this morning it will be sent to 50,000 email. So what will happen? Tomorrow morning I need to see, okay, how many of these people have opened up my email, how many have not opened up. So tomorrow morning again I have to log into my system and set up another campaign which will only be sent to this person. These people, say around 20,000 people opened up my email, will send to this same campaign, then another 20,000 people have not opened my email. I have to manually create another campaign for those people, think about something more creative. And based upon that, we can think about the entire, the tree. But what happens in a drip campaign? Drip campaign is like, it's more of like a very automated, a very efficient campaign. So for example, I kind of create a campaign. I'll show you that as well. So the next slide is almost about that. So this is how it happens. For example, I sent an email campaign to this 1900 bot office. Out of those 1900, imagine, the machine gets to know in real time, after a day's time, I've kind of sent a trigger here, which will tell me that, out of this 1800, how many people have opened up the email. For example, the first campaign was set up day one. 274 people have opened up, and the rest 1604 people have not opened up. Based on that, we can have another campaign. So I just have to need to set this campaign only once in 3 months time or 6 months time based upon the way you want to play it up, and then just enjoy the show. So once this entire assets and everything, this implementation thing is done, you don't need to create everything, don't need to do all this thing every time. The machine works for you based upon the activity of a person. For example, you can send this email and towards the next campaign. Now think about this. For example, there was a campaign that was sent to say 500 people here, and after like 2 days time machine has seen that say 200 people have opened up, it will go here. 300 people have not opened up, goes here. So sometimes I've not opened up my email, I can still try once more time, I can send the same email to him because I already know that he has not opened up my email. Otherwise, without this tool, I'll never get to know if he has opened up my email or not. Until else you actually reply back to him. Right, but the machine knows that you have opened up the email or not. So based upon that, because you have not opened the email, the machine will again try once more after 2 days. And if you have happened to open up my email, now what will happen? I can have a follow-up email set. For example, I am sharing about marketing cloud or any of the product or the service. I can, in my next follow-up campaign, I can say, hey, I sent you an email 2 days back, and I'm just wondering if we can have a 30-minute communication call. Because I'm confident enough, I know that you've opened up my email. So if you have opened up the email, you have actually read the email, right? And based upon that again, you wait for another 2 days, someone does not reply back. Because he has opened up two emails, you can send up a third follow-up campaign and like it, go ahead. And if he's not responding, you can probably send another alpha beta kind of a campaign and send something else and end the event. So the entire objective is to reach out to people, build some awareness around your name, your brand's name, and then if they're not responding, see, it's fine. I reach out to 50,000 people. I cannot reach 50,000 leads out of it. Not even 10,000. At most I can expect 500. Maybe I can expect 50. That's the average discount. But the point is that the effort is too large. But actually I get to know at one stage that this is actually 20, 50 or 100 prospects who are actually engaging with my content. Now instead of actually reaching out to 50,000 people, now I know this is the 50 people whom I can actually take them to the next stage. And this is where the harder thing comes in. Just like something which was left was the forms. We can have some forms. The landing page will create, we will have the forms. So all the data that you fill up on that landing page will get directly saved in part of. Also synced up with the sales. So in the real time, you can actually see that data if someone has linked to my website, filled up a form, the entire data is there in the sales form. Next part is the landing page, what we talked about, search marketing. It's just like a small add-on. It's a part of this part of where you can actually track all those keywords where it is ranking. Next is the segmentation. We have already spoken about it. Segmentation is like, you know, we segment all the lists. Then is social, so all the tweets and everything, it's all cooked up, it's all tracked. Everything you do, all these smart companies have everything in this track. All the Bitly links, all the WWW2, WWW3 kind of links are all tracked. They're getting tracked at every single point of time. So you can't really think about it, but yes, they're being tracked every point of time. It's not only about Facebook, but 7, Twitter, it's all about your email and everything. We feel okay, I've not opened up my email in the email and I'm not getting tracked. I'm getting tracked right from the moment that email has come to my inbox. Next was the real sales alert. So this is something the automation rules that I set. I want to notify my salesperson about, you know, particular lead or prospect, any kind of activity, social tweets, likings, blah blah blah, and email token. Demo seen, for example, we see some demo on Salesforce Pardot, and I've left a lead on their website. Now the sales guy in the sales team, without I am reaching out to him, he gets to know before I, you know, speak to him that okay, I've seen this demo or something. Next is the prospect tracking and analytics. You can have some deep dive analytics into it. You can see how many times customer has been to your website, what kind of content is liking, which service pages, for example, I have 10 services, which services, for example, Mr. A likes or Mr. B likes. So everyone, you know, gets down into this dirty, which I just showed. Next is reporting. You can have your own reporting or something will tell you the basic level of reporting. So this is the actual power of Pardot, wherein, you know, you don't have to manually do everything, have all the assets ready. And you know, once you have all these assets ready, you just have to quickly, you know, set up a campaign. You just, you know, there's an engagement program into Salesforce, this Pardot. This kind of a thing will open. You just have to select, send email, which email you have to select, the name of that email. Notify assigned user means the person who owns that account into the Salesforce. So he gets to know it real time. And that's how all these digital campaigns can be created. We have a social thing. You have seen that, right? In the previous slides. So I'm going to do social thing. So what I can do is, like, so in this particular thing, social, I can, you know, kind of schedule the posts, the tweets, and everything. And it has a Bitly link kind of a thing. I can have an indicator or a connector connected to it. I can have some short URL kind of a thing. And in fact, it's not Bitly, you can have a vanity URL, which looks like your website URL, but not actually your website URL. These are the web pages which are posted on the part of server. Right. So to you, it will look like, okay, it is my www.abc.com. So whenever you go to any of these social media and, you know, you get to see my ads somewhere, so it is all getting tracked with the help of this part. Does it answer your question?
So in the social part, for Facebook, what kind of information do we see in the part? When it's integrated to see.
Good question. Yeah. So for example, I can integrate my LinkedIn social channel, I can integrate my Facebook and Twitter. So these three channels. So these are the most important channels for a marketing point of view, for the business marketing point of view, right? So you know, coming back to your question, what kind of information you can see is, for example, you know, there was a tweet this morning say, hey, join my session at India Day, right? So there is one analytics which will come into my the Twitter channel, the analytics.twitter.com. There I can see, okay, it will be anonymous kind of information. It will say, you know, say 10,000 impressions, say 50 likes, 20 retweets, and those kind of things. So 20 retweets and 50 likes, I can still see, okay, these are the people like surprised there, right? But I can't actually think about, like, you know, out of these 20 or 50, I can actually manually check all my tweets and see that Shipra was a prospect and had she, you know, kind of liked any of my posts. So this tool has a reporting system which will tell you, you know, you click on that particular tweet inside this tool and then you get the data out of it, that how many prospects which were a part of your campaign has actually liked, disliked, or done any kind of activity. Even in fact not liked or disliked or whatsoever it is, then actually click, which you probably didn't knew because it was not a repeat, it was not a like. But they have clicked on the link and have been here. You can see that. That answers the
answer.
It is not about the SEO. So for SEO intelligence, you can use a 2.52. It will tell you about any damn thing you think about you want to know. Spyfu. SPYFU.com. Yeah. It's an awesome tool. You can actually have a good intelligence on your competitor URLs, which keywords they are ranking, which keywords they are not ranking, which keywords you are ranking, because probably with a manual effort you can just think about something from a logical mechanism, actually not get to know okay, what button where I'm tracking. So spy tool is where it's that can help. But part of can help you out only with the set of keywords. You say, okay, I wanna see that, you know, say on a you know best school company in India, am I ranking or not? That you can actually you know feed in the school and then school will tell you if you're ranking or not. If it's a change in your ranking, is it coming up you know in a positive way, it's dipping up or whatsoever.
Keywords.
So very very good thing. So the best part of Pardot is you can enable SEO. So for example, you can enable and you can disable also. A lot of companies, especially in the marketing space, when they have a you know a target or something, they don't want their competitor to know that they have a landing page. For example, if you ask me, I'll probably disallow my landing page to be crawled by Google because you know I want to check my ROI. You know, end of the day, I want to know this is the money I'm invested in Pardot, and if that goes live on the Google thing, you know, there will be hundreds of leads coming up from that channel. I can't really see, okay, my SEO team is working well or my marketing is working well. So at times you disallow intentionally that Google, let not Google crawl that thing. That answers the question. So agile environment, so they form like agility kind of a thing. So you keep on checking what is working, what is not working, test. Keep testing your campaigns, you know, send at 7 a.m, send at 7:30 a.m. So like I told you, I have two types of team, one is the IST, which is like sales team, and one is the part of user team. So IST is the team which is sending you know manual emails to a lot of people in the market, and then you know something which is working for them might not be working for me from the part of the company. I keep tracking, you know, I'm sending at 7 a.m. in the morning, 7:30 a.m, 10 a.m. in the morning, midnight, early morning, what is working, what is not working. So keep testing your subject lines, keep testing your content, the send times. These are the three most important things that you keep on checking. So, how does the success look like with Pardot? So far, we have kind of, you know, gauged that this is the power of this tool. I can have a lot of automation done, let the machine work for me, send email. 50,000 people, then automatically see, okay, after 2 days, 20,000 people opened up, okay, send this campaign, send that campaign. 30,000 people have not opened my email, send that campaign, does not send this campaign, notify users and all that thing. And I'm at my relief, I'm sitting just, you know, and looking at my, you know, the system, getting to know, okay, you know, this is what's happening, the ROI is coming out of it. So, success, the best part is that, you know, we have some pipeline, so, you know, this is how it will tell you. For example, this is the number of visitors that it has you know, interacted with. These are the number of prospects. These are MQL, which is marketing qualified leads. For example, marketing people say, okay, we have sent you 2500 leads to sales guys, and out of those 2500 leads, or like 1500 for this example, 127 for the sales qualified, where sales people said, okay, I spoke to this person. So, marketing people always say that, you know, we have sent you this big number of. This guy is kind of laughing, so I'm feeling that you know he probably knows what is the pain of a marketer. A lot of marketing people they send a lot of leads to the sales guy, and towards the end only 10% of those leads are qualified to the sales guy because they say okay 90%. So they are just you know kind of trying to know about this tool or this service. They are not interested in buying that. And that's to an extent that's right off. So that's how you know, this entire funnel goes down. 55,000 to this 127 and the actual want leads to be just a very common. But yes, you know, to see the BD size, this is like not even 10% of the revenue that we as a company are generating from Pardot. You've just spent $10,000 for 1 year and we have actually achieved more than $5 lakh or something revenue with the help of Pardot. It's actually true. I wish Pardot team gave me something. Okay, so if you just want to have a look on you know, the guided work, I wanted to spend some time, but I think we are here, so might be approaching a deadline. So you can actually visit this URL, pardot.com. What is it? Okay. And I'll come to this section, this is the demo section. And then,
So,
because it's a product.
So, you can push data to Salesforce, right?
No, no, you can only pull and push, but you can't actually have the kind of database of Salesforce directly imported into Pardot. You have to manually download from Salesforce, import it. Social Studio is like
Social Studio.
That app.
Okay,
so when
you integrate,
so
do you have a plugin with
the part of the system? Yeah, so it's not actually a plugin, it's just the API
code
match that it was. So when you,
so
if I have to
cloud the
report
out of Salesforce
or
the part of
it. Right. So does Pardot
use
a
native
report
builder of Salesforce to cloud
reports? Can do it. Can do it the way you want it. Because your Salesforce campaign, so yeah, so because your Salesforce campaign, your Pardot campaign, you want to sync up data, you want to, because so, Pardot has a very high level kind of reporting system. You want to go for a deep dive, have some the kind of reporting system which is actually available in Salesforce. Because it's integrated, you can always collect data from the Salesforce reporting system.
So I have
long
for
the Salesforce.
So I am concerned, I have used DAMCO. So if I have to compare,
you can throw some light on. Yeah. So I'm an active user of HubSpot also. And I've been in love with HubSpot as well. But how we have placed it into the entire ecosystem is like, we have HubSpot codes available on our website. So all your backend journey is actually mapped very effectively with the help of HubSpot. But moving forward, whenever you are falling to prey on any of my the engagement campaigns, then Pardot works really well, because the entire, so the integration of HubSpot is not really good. The interface of the same. The Salesforce is not really good to the help of. So I have actually integrated MailChimp also. So it was like really hopeless. Have to refresh something, keep on refreshing, then it will do some data. So none of the sales guys are crazy enough to actually see, I'm trying to call up this guy and what is the impact, right?
So you
sales,
have to separate
vendor
and then look at
it. Yes. That was completely, that's a big time nonsense to my sales team. So yes, that is how we invested so much into Pardot, and this is given us very good results. Because one, A was the notification thing, because with the help of Salesforce and Pardot integration, notifications were coming up very well. HubSpot was not there. HubSpot just gives you, but it will not tell you if that particular prospect is actually into your Salesforce ecosystem. Because it's not connected to that.
Okay, so you keep saying, so wherever I see a lot of, whenever I create a campaign, and then which is ROI.
Right. Yeah.
Company might have invested in a license that might be recurring, and then they want to start. Why? How does it
track? Which license, like
the part of
it? Okay.
How? Why am I concerned about the ROI in that particular campaign? You keep saying you can calculate, or you can see the kind of ROI that you have received from the campaign. How do you calculate that ROI?
Very, very good. So, this year in the month of May, I in the States, there was a one region which spent so much into it, we were the platinum bar. It's an actual real case study. So we have invested so much. So for example, X amount, say a lakh dollar kind of real investment. We got like 200 or 500 odd leads. Right? But the sales guys have a definite, unlimited bandwidth. For example, even sales guy, you find a prospect, you call me today, tomorrow, after like three times, they'll say, but I'm busy, you don't call me. You stop chasing me, right? If I'll be blunt enough to say that. Right, so how does Pardot helps us out? Because I've already invested so much into the event. Now I want to calculate the ROI, getting out of that event. I keep sending you emails from the Pardot entity. Based upon your response, you'll go from one campaign to another inside this entire event. All these drip campaigns, lead nurturing and all. I'll not sell you anything. I'll only educate. I'll keep sharing my ebooks, keep sharing my blog, my case studies. And now, over a period of time, maybe 2 months down the line, 5 months down the line, you feel, okay, boss, no, this is something which I was looking for. And you have actually, met someone at a booth, at that event. It's a good way that, there's a high chances of getting you converted. Right, so this is how we calculate the ROI. For example, how many people out of those 500 leads which I generated from that particular trade show, with the help of Pardot, I'm able to convert.
I think this is not a very good feature. I tell you why. Most of the people that you meet, for example, tech shows. Okay? So you don't get to meet DC level people.
Of course.
You get to see maybe writing it.
So 10% is the season taker, 90% is the chapter.
Correct. Not just I would say, but yeah, the kind of people that we are not.
Not the decision makers.
Yeah, not the decision makers.
They can't take decisions.
Yes. So now what happens is I go back, I have captured the data, not for the developers maybe, but for the IT heads.
Right.
They are not the decision makers.
Right.
When I create a lead out of it, the lead doesn't allow me to create multiple contacts. Okay?
Yeah, of course. Or in Salesforce.
Any CRM.
Okay.
It doesn't allow me to create multiple contacts.
So you get many leads then?
Yeah. So you
the same.
So I talk to the IT head, I create another lead.
Right.
Which is not linked to the campaign.
Right.
And if I convert that, it has not been tracked.
So good thing is that when you create that new lead in Salesforce, you map it to the marketing campaign of that lead. Because it has come with the influence of that actual lead whom you met.
Okay.
That is how you get the answer. And
so Pardot license, Pardot app, does it only work with Salesforce or can it also work independently?
So it goes really well with Salesforce, but I think it goes independently.
Yeah.
But it works phenomenally good with the Alpha. I go crazy with that. It's an awesome thing.
But end customer is also using market.
Right.
And they are not sure if
it's
going market or
market. Market is almost at the same level, but only because of the integration part, I say part. Because it's the same, you know, family owned Salesforce versus part of IT. Because the same Salesforce connectivity. So you get an activity history. So as soon as you open up a lead inside the Salesforce, you know, the interface, right away, you know, once you scroll down where it's, you know, your activity, so it gets synced up. For example, you logged a call or something, and next my email went, then you actually set a particular one-to-one email, you know, based on that, so it is getting feeded up real-time into that activity. And that is how, you know, people are getting to know. So you don't have to pull data, refresh, or has to be pop-up kind of a thing. It's all there in the system.
So,
once
I punch
it
in Salesforce, from Pardot, once I sync it in Salesforce,
it is already, it will tap automatically.
Standard campaign
change. Yeah. And that's how we calculate the ROI. Otherwise, it's crazy.
Salesforce engaged. What is the role of Salesforce engaged
in product? So, it goes well. I was about to do my channel, but I didn't think we have a time.
Do you need a Salesforce engaged for sales people to look at the Pardot information?
So, I would say because sales people will never do it. But he's from the sales guy. He'll prefer to call someone. For example, I'm responsible, he'll call me right away rather than, you know, looking up all the problems. I've seen my sales team also. Whatever the highest level of, you know, cooked lead, low hanging food and share with them, they don't want, you know, something cooked food in the plate which they can, you know, really eat right away. So you know, the engaged results and all that, alerts and everything, it's good from a marketing point of view because that's the kind of intelligence you can send some email to a sales guy and say, hey, I have seen this by the way. And in fact, 2 days back I saw one of the prospect of one of my sales guy. He was not actually, you know, calling up that guy. So I manually took that up. I saw that this guy actually interacted with my website in 1 month, say 40 times. He has been to a number of pages, liked my content, videos, demos, blah blah blah. This guy was like, you know, not chasing that. So I wrote, including, you know, CC'd my CEO of the company. I made sure this guy, you know, bumps up and, you know, have a in-person meeting with this prospect. And that's how, you know, that is, you have to, you know, it's a carrot and stick kind of thing.
My question is more towards, like, do sales team need a engagement license of anything to see the part of information?
No. Yeah, because it is integrated, so data is built on it. It's not a two-way kind of a thing. It syncs up, but it does not allow Salesforce to directly transfer data to Pardot. If you have the same lead in both these systems, it works well and gets automatically synced up.
So my next question is, like, the Salesforce Marketing Cloud overcomes this thing. Like, the Salesforce Marketing Cloud has direct connection with the Salesforce. We can transfer it through the connectors.
Yeah.
We can. It is a two-way.
Yes, I know. I know.
Why Pardot and why not Salesforce Marketing Cloud?
Okay, very good. So because I told you, if you want to reach out to masses, millions of emails, then Marketing Cloud will help. It has a SMS thing, it has all these chasing things, you know, entire thing. But the drip campaigns and all this lead nurturing process will only happen in the cloud. You have a small
Cloud also, we have personalized email, we also have conversion tracking. tracking.
Yeah.
So if, for example, if my company is buying
license, you know, the standard license will give you an access to 10,000 contacts. You have to keep buying 10,000. Of course, there will be a limit. You want to reach out to 5 million people, right? You can't really buy so many buckets of cardboard. Then marketing cloud is the right solution. If you have a decent, because B2B, that's why I told you about B2B. B2B is never like a million kind of thing. At most, you have 40,000-50,000 kind of prospects in your database. You keep nurturing them, keep bagging them. That's how you B2B. That is their part of it.
One last question. Yeah. Use case with you for a B2C implementation product?
I have not done it, but I am ready to come. But then marketing cloud, you can write it. Cardboard will also be very expensive if you want to reach out to B2C. Because you will have like millions of prospects. You want to reach out to them.
Big sector of companies, a couple of people.
How many prospects do you think you have in your database?
15,000.
15,000? Of course, cardboard. Yeah. Anything less than 1 or 2 lakhs kind of a thing, the cardboard will do.
Because I feel a lot of social things which is not there. Like only email part I can see which is a part of. Is it really, helpful for a B2C company?
It is really helpful. It's really helpful. Either B2B or B2C, because you have less number of prospects in B2C, it is definitely helpful. See, for example, if you don't know, you are reaching out to 50,000 people, you don't know. And because at the end of the day, they reply back to you, you don't know what is happening. I send out 20 emails in a 1 month's time, you never reply back to me. I never know, you have opened up an email or not, boss. Is it worth sending you email in the next month or not? With the help of Pardot, I still get to know that you are opening up my email, you are coming to my website. You are not leaving anything to me. You are not dropping a lead to me. But I still get to know everything that you are doing with my brand. Watching any YouTube video, you are attending my webinars, you have registered and not again, attended, then also I get to. Entire database is next. So a lot of tools are actually connected at a single platform at Pardot. And that's how it is, helping marketers know a lot of those things that people don't really know. Until unless a prospect comes back to them and say, hey, nah, I don't buy this, or can we get a demo of this?
So,
like I said, the best part, because market is usually really good. There's a balance. HubSpot is also good. I would say 80% HubSpot, and there was the market over the part of the problem, the same thing. But the only best part of part of it is the integration. Because if you don't have a good integration, there's a bad hand, it's going to be wasted. That's really good. Yeah. So you can end this at your convenience, get to know about this, and I can take you a couple of things. Educate. Not save something. Don't sell something. Yes. Yes. You have to educate the prospects. Don't sell anything. Like I'm educated, I'm not told. Probably the same that I asked for anything. Present targeted campaign only works. No static only emails. Focus, targeted, I'm going to reach out to US audience. The US content, US campaigns, see US less kind of a difference that has to happen. Because they feel local, they feel like, That's it from my side.